I'm delighted that we are having our first Western A Prize Foundation conference here today, and I'm very grateful to Philip Ridley and to his team for organizing it. It's a wonderful organization. I'm honored and delighted that Sally came here and gave us her wonderful presentation, because this is a heroic woman. This is one of my heroes, this lady. She has taken on the corporate America, the corporate food industry, pharmaceutical industry, agricultural industry in America. And these are not small guys to take on. And her organization grew from a very small beginning to a huge organization. How many people you've got now, Sally? About 12,000 members worldwide. And these are all people who are going to change things on this planet. With our destructive agriculture, with our destructive ways of living, our destructive lifestyles, we are overtaxing, overconsuming our planet. We are borrowing from our children and our grandchildren the planetary resources and consuming them as if there is no tomorrow. And it's people like you and people like Western A Prize Organization and people like that who are going to change things, who are going to ensure that human race does survive on this planet and that our planet survives. Because what we're doing at the moment, thanks to corporate powers and the governments which serve them, we are destroying our mother planet. And once you destroy your mother, where are we going to live? Where are we going to exist? So let's start from what I'm going to talk about today. Gut and psychology syndrome, gut and physiology syndrome. In short, GAP syndrome. As Julian already introduced, I have written the book on this condition in 2004. It's a gut and psychology syndrome. At the moment, I'm working on my second book called Gut and Physiology Syndrome, which will cover all the physical conditions which are connected with the functioning of the digestive system. As Sally already mentioned, our gut not only holds about 85% of our immune system, so it's our major and the most important immune organ in the body, but it also has the second brain. It holds our second brain, and the two brains talk to each other all the time. The digestive system is one of the most important organs, the most basic organs in our bodies. All diseases begin in the gut. This phrase was coined by Hippocrates all those thousands of years ago. And the more we learn with all our scientific muscle nowadays, the more we realize just how right he was, how correct he was. All diseases begin in the gut. And GAP syndrome establishes a connection between the functioning of the digestive system of the person and the functioning of the brain. And I say in my second book, I will be talking about the functioning of the digestive system and its connection with the functioning of the rest of the organs in the body. Many, many other chronic degenerative conditions that our population is suffering from. When we talk about the digestive system, we have to talk about what lives there and what takes care of it. We have to talk about the housekeepers of our second brain and our major immune system organ and the organ which feeds us and protects us and detoxifies us. We have to talk about gut flora. I'm sure people here are enlightened people. You all know what gut flora is. You've heard the word. You've heard about probiotics. The scientists recently in Scandinavia have established the fact that about 90% of all cells and all genetic material in your body is your gut flora. So we are just about 10% of our bodies. We only are a shell that holds this microscopic world inside us. And we ignore that world at our peril, its role in our physiology and psychology and functioning of those 10% of us is so fundamental that because we have ignored it for such a long time, our health status is in such a bad way at the moment. So when we talk about the gut, we have to talk about gut flora and we have to talk about its many functions. If you take the digestive system of a human being and put it flat, it will cover a tennis court, a digestive system of an adult. It's a huge surface for anything harmful from the environment to get into your temple, to get into your body. So nature found a perfect solution to that problem. It covered every square millimeter of that tennis court with a thick band of bacteria, viruses, fungi, protozoa, and other micro creatures which form our gut flora. And this thick band of probiotic microbes in your gut, they fulfill so many functions in our bodies that if somebody one day decided to sterilize our gut, we would simply die. We would not survive. First of all, they provide protection from anything that comes with food and drink into our digestive system and the rest of the body. They produce every antibiotic under the sun, every antiviral substance under the sun, every antifungal substance. They do not allow exoworms to hatch. They control all sorts of parasites that come in with food and drink all the time. But on top of that, the digestive process, as we break down the food and digest it, produces a lot of toxic substances as byproducts. These bacteria that live in our gut flora have an ability to grab hold of these toxic substances. And if they cannot detoxify them, if they cannot neutralize them, they take them out of the system. Because when you eliminate, most of stool that comes out of us is made out of bacteria. These bacteria constantly multiply, they produce babies all the time, and they die out themselves because many of them live only a few days. So most of your stool is bacteria. So whatever toxic substances they've grabbed hold of, they would hold until they die and until they eliminate these toxins out of your system. And here we can talk about the heavy metals. Heavy metals are a big issue. There are books written about heavy metals causing autism and dyslexia and ADHD and schizophrenia and chronic fatigue syndrome and many, many other chronic degenerative conditions. The governments have established the fact now that we have polluted our oceans with the mercury and that all fish species and all seafood now contains mercury. So the government advice that's been published on the other side of the pond and here to limit the fish consumption. However, the research shows that people who do not limit their fish consumption overall are healthier than people who do. And what science has found that it is our gut flora that is the first and most important barrier in eliminating mercury and lead and aluminium and arsenic and every other toxic metal and many carcinogenic substances and all other toxic substances that come into our digestive system or are produced in that digestive system. They chelate them. From the word chele, the Greek word for a crab's claw. They grab hold of it like a claw and then they would not let go of that mercury molecule or lead molecule until they take them out. I've got a very interesting paper where the scientists have taken two groups of rats and fed them organic mercury in their drink. The first group of rats had normal, healthy gut flora. The second group of rats was treated with a powerful group of antibiotics to wipe out their gut flora, to sterilize their gut in a way. And then after the rats were fed the organic mercury, they were examined and they were killed and their tissues were examined. And what the scientists have found that only about 1% of that organic mercury got into the bloodstream of rats who had normal gut flora. And more than 90% of that organic mercury was in the bodies of the rats who had sterilized gut. So our first and most important barrier in preventing poisoning with heavy metals, carcinogens, and other toxins that we have pumped into our environment is our own gut flora. If it is intact, if it is well-functioning, if it is healthy, you can eat fish as much as you like, and you will be protected from mercury and from lead and from many other pollutants. PCBs are in our oceans, organophosphates are in our oceans, not only mercury, all sorts of pollutants that we have pumped into our oceans. Health and integrity of the gut relies almost entirely on the health and integrity of the gut flora. Our gut is lined by very sophisticated cells called enterocytes. And these cells only live a few days. They get born at the bottom of the crypts, they travel up the villi, and then they get shed off. And this process of these cells being born healthy and normal and fulfilling their functions and then being shed off is orchestrated by beneficial flora. When the beneficial flora is not there, this process gets upset, the cells mutate, they turn cancerous. You cannot develop cancer in your digestive system if you've got healthy, well-functioning gut flora. It will not allow that. And on the other side of this coin, every cancer in the digestive system begins from damage to the gut flora. So colon cancer, which is becoming one of the leading cancers in the country, is due to abnormalities in the gut flora and can be traced to some course of powerful antibiotic several years prior to developing cancer in a person. or some other powerful drug that destroys gut flora, or some other influence in there. So coming back to the gut lining, to the gut wall, which is so essential for us, the cell regeneration process in there is very, very active. The cells are being shed all the time and replaced by newly born cells. And this process is orchestrated by the gut flora. They look after our gut lining. And when the gut flora is damaged, then the gut lining deteriorates, degenerates, and the person cannot digest or absorb food properly. And all sorts of undigested food start leaking into the bloodstream of the person, causing food allergies and intolerance. And all sorts of toxic substances start leaking into the bloodstream as well. Appropriate digestion and absorption simply cannot happen without well-functioning gut flora. They produce every digestive enzyme under the sun. They produce substances which actively transport minerals and vitamins and other nutrients through the gut lining. Without them, without the well-functioning gut flora, you cannot assimilate minerals. You cannot assimilate zinc, you cannot assimilate magnesium, you cannot assimilate calcium, you cannot assimilate all those essential minerals that we need. Because in order for them to cross the gut lining, they need to be transported. They need to be chelated by very special acids, which these bacteria produce, and then these acids transport them in an organic form into the bloodstream. And in that form, the body recognizes them and uses them. But if you have inorganic minerals, you can have lots of mineral supplements, and there are many mineral supplements on the market now from various sources. If you've got poorly functioning gut flora, they will be going in and out of you. They will not be absorbing, and your body will not be using them appropriately. Vitamin production is another very, very important function of our gut flora. Not only it ensures that we digest our food properly, break it down properly, and absorb nutrients from it properly, it also actively synthesizes a whole host of vitamins and other active substances, which we cannot get out of food that easily. The whole B vitamin group is produced by gut flora. Our gut flora is the source of B vitamins in our body. B1 and B2 and B6 and B12 and B3 and biotin and many, many other natural substances. Vitamin K2, our main source of vitamin K2 in the body that Sally was talking about, is our own gut flora. If the gut flora is well functioning and intact, it will provide you with these vitamins. Why did nature do this? Because most of these vitamins are water soluble. They don't stay in the body very long. Even if you have foods rich in these vitamins or take supplements, they will not stay in the body long, and there will be periods during the day when you are deficient. And these vitamins are absolutely vital for us to have every second of our existence. So what did Mother Nature do? It found the perfect solution to this problem. It provided us with our own little factory inside our digestive system, which is constantly producing good amounts of these vitamins and other active substances and releasing them into your bloodstream in good amounts all the time, whether you're awake or asleep, whether you're eating or fasting, whether you're in a concentration camp and you're being starved. Your gut flora will still provide you with plenty of B12 and other vitamins and K2 if it's well functioning and if it's in a good shape. And it's when we lose the gut flora, that's when people become pale and pasty. They become anemic because they're B vitamin deficient. And I find that my clinic and many, many other practitioners find that no matter what we do, the person still stays pale and pasty and still tests anemic on blood tests until we restore the gut flora. Because it is our gut flora that is the main source of these vitamins. Detoxification we already touched. They chelate, these bacteria chelate toxic substances and take them out of the system. They chelate all the cancer-causing substances. And immune system modulation, this is a huge function of our gut flora. About 84-85% of all our immunity is located in the gut wall. Billions of neutrophils pass through the gut wall every single day. It is a major, major immune organ, and there is a constant conversation going on between the gut flora and this immune system, this 85% of your immunity. Constant talk, constant conversation. And it is the gut flora that is a major balancing agent for our immunity. And when the gut flora is upset, when it's abnormal, when it's deficient, your immunity simply cannot be healthy. The first thing that happens in majority of people, that major arms of immunity, TH1 and TH2 immunity, get out of balance. And when they're out of balance, the person becomes allergic. Instead of reacting appropriately to pollen in the air, or to your makeup, or to your shampoo, or to your foods, or to other substances in the environment, your immune system starts reacting inappropriately and you start developing allergic reactions. I'm sure you met people, most of you met people who say, I've never been allergic to anything, and suddenly I became allergic to milk. And then a month later, I became allergic to my mascara. And now I'm allergic to my washing powder. And now I'm allergic to my perfume. And now I'm allergic to lanolin. I can't wear wool anymore. And the list goes on, and these things usually accelerate. And you can trace the beginning of this problem to some good course of antibiotics or some other event in the person's life which damaged the gut flora. And if the gut flora is damaged, the immunity gets out of balance, it cannot react to environment appropriately anymore and starts reacting inappropriately, you become sensitive and you become allergic to various things. What can damage our gut flora? I'm sure all of you can, having read this list, all of you can say that you've been exposed to at least a few items on this list. Antibiotics is the number one factor in our modern world, without doubt, because antibiotics kill the good and the bad. They have saved billions of lives, antibiotics, without doubt. They're wonderful drugs, and there are situations when they're essential. However, they kill the good and the bad. And the trouble is, it's the beneficial bacteria in the gut, the probiotic bacteria, which are the most vulnerable species to broad-spectrum antibiotics. They go first, before the pathogens start dying. They do recover, but it takes different species of beneficial bacteria different amount of time to recover. Some take a couple of weeks, others take a couple of months. And that's a window of opportunity for a pathogen to get into that niche, which has been emptied by antibiotics, to establish itself. And once it's established there, it's very difficult to drive it out, to smoke it out of there. The recovering beneficial bacteria have a fight on their hands. And two species of microbes that we've studied quite well, which are resistant to broad-spectrum antibiotics, are two particularly rampant species in our modern world, in the Western world in particular. One is yeast of Candida species. It's resistant to broad-spectrum antibiotics. It is normally controlled by beneficial flora. Every time we wipe out the beneficial flora, they have a heyday. They have a special opportunity to establish themselves. Another group are Clostridia bacteria. There's about 100 members of this family, of Clostridia family. They all produce very potent neurotoxins, toxic substances which affect the nervous system, and not just the brain in the cranium, but the brain in your gut as well, they affect. The most commonly known species is Clostridium tetani. It lives in every soil. Every sample of soil on this planet tests positive for Clostridium tetani spores. These are spore-forming bacteria, which means they cannot be eradicated, they cannot be destroyed. The spores survive freezing, survive boiling, they survive anything, pretty much. And they hatch, they can wait for years and years before they hatch. That's why a healthy human person in a healthy human gut, there's plenty of Clostridia living in there. Most pathogenic, most dangerous species of Clostridia. But as long as the beneficial bacteria predominate in there, they keep them under control. They do not allow them to multiply too much. And they detoxify, they inoculate their toxins, neutralize their toxins, so these toxins cannot do us any harm. But when the beneficial bacteria are wiped out by a course of antibiotics, Clostridia, which is resistant to broad-spectrum antibiotics, has a heyday. They not only start establishing themselves, they not only start overgrowing, but their toxins now are not neutralized. And they can get through the gut lining, these toxins. And they cause a lot of neurological and psychiatric symptoms once they get into the brain, once they get into the bloodstream. So these are just the two species of pathogenic microbes which can overgrow if we damage our gut flora. After every course of antibiotics, that's what's happened. That is why it is vital to take probiotics when you take antibiotics and to eat fermented foods in order to replenish your gut flora every time. And unfortunately, doctors don't know about it and do not tell their patients about it and do not recommend it. They just give out antibiotics for people to take. Steroids, the contraceptive pill, has a devastating effect on gut flora. And unfortunately, our ladies start taking it at a very young age and take it for quite a few years before they're ready to start their family. So there is quite a lot of damage done to their gut flora. Stress, other drugs, all prescription medication on a repeat basis, which you take for long periods of time, will have an altering effect on the gut flora. It will change the composition of the gut flora and initiate all sorts of unpleasant processes in there. Infections, disease, chronic disease, bottle feeding. Bottle-fed infants develop completely different gut flora to the breastfed infants. And this gut flora predisposes them, first of all, to allergies, to atopic conditions such as asthma and eczema in these children, and then to various infections and various other problems. Glue ear is very, very common amongst bottle-fed children, again, because they do not develop normal flora on their mucous membranes. Old age, that is the time when people should take probiotics and should eat fermented foods on a regular basis. Pollution, radiation, alcohol, overconsumption of alcohol, toxic chemicals, and dental work. Dental work is particularly important. I'm delighted to see a table with dentists here today, with ecologically trained dentists, because pretty much everything the dentist puts into your teeth and puts into your mouth is toxic, and toxic for your gut flora. And for weeks afterwards, you'll be swallowing these things, and they will be having an effect on your gut flora. That is another thing that dentists have to tell their patients, that take probiotics after visiting me for a few weeks. It's very, very important. And pay attention to your diet for a few weeks after you've seen the dentist. So what is a typical scenario I see in my clinic? We're talking about gut and psychology, gut and physiology syndrome, conditions which begin in the digestive tract and then spread all over the body. Before I talk about the health of the child, whether the patient is a child or whether it's an adult, I would always begin with questions about the health of their mother or their father, or even grandparents. Why is it important? Whenever parents or families mention, people immediately think about genetics. But there's something far more important, and just as important maybe, that the parents pass to their child at the time of birth. It's the gut flora. And what I find that in children with autism, with ADHD, with dyslexia, dyspraxia, and other behavioral and learning disabilities, I find that 100% of moms have got abnormal gut flora. And that's what they've passed to their children at birth. Because babies have got sterile digestive system, they've got sterile bodies while they're in the womb, as far as science is concerned. And as the baby goes through the birth canal at the time of birth, the baby swallows first mouthfuls of bacteria. So whatever lives in mom's birth canal, that's what becomes the baby's gut flora. Where does the flora in the vagina come from? It comes from the bowel. So whatever lives in mom's bowel, that's what would live in her vagina, and that's what would live in her birth canal. And also the father has got his own growing flora, which comes from his bowel, and he shares that flora with the mother on a regular basis. So the fathers are not exempt either. So whatever lives in mom's birth canal, that's what the baby acquires. And if the mother has got abnormal gut flora, that's what she would pass to her baby. So the baby starts its life from abnormalities in the gut flora. Babies are also born with an immature immune system. Establishment of normal gut flora in the first 20 or so days of life plays a crucial role in appropriate maturation of the baby's immune system. And if the baby acquired abnormal gut flora, then the baby is left immune compromised. So every bug, every virus that goes around, the baby will get. So ear infections are very common amongst these children. They usually go from one ear infection to the next until grommets are inserted. They are diagnosed with glue ear. And of course, every cause of ear infection is treated with antibiotics. And the antibiotics would damage whatever precious little beneficial bacteria the child has acquired from the mother. And the repeat courses of antibiotics would cause further damage to the child. Chest infections are a second most common infection amongst these children. And again, it's treated with antibiotics in these children. So further damage to gut flora and to the immune system occurs in these children. And that usually happens in the first year of life. First year of life is the time usually when the baby is breastfed. I know that many babies are bottle-fed in our world, but with all the education that is going on, more and more young ladies are now doing their best to try and breastfeed the baby. While the mother's breastfeeding the baby, despite the fact that she has got abnormal gut flora herself, she would have antibodies against her own gut flora. She will have immune protection in there. It may not be 100% sufficient, but she will have some protection. And that protection she will be passing through her breast milk. So despite the fact that her baby acquired abnormal gut flora from her from the start, while the baby is breastfed, there is some protection from the breast milk. But when the breastfeeding stops, that's when the whole situation deteriorates. That's what I usually see, that while the child is breastfed, the development is normal. When the breastfeeding stops, several months down the road, autistic features start appearing, or hyperactivity starts appearing, or other learning or behavioral problems start appearing in the child, because the whole situation deteriorates. Then, of course, vaccinations join the bandwagon. The child is immune compromised. The child's immune system is not ready for vaccinations. It's not fit enough to be vaccinated. And that's to put aside all the issues with vaccinations. Vaccines are full of a lot of harmful substances. And they're full of a lot of animal proteins, antigens, which the immune system may not be ready for. However, millions and millions of children all over the world are vaccinated, and they do not develop autism, and they do not develop learning disabilities. And I see a growing number of autistic children in my clinic now who have not been vaccinated at all. So vaccinations do not cause autism. They are not the cause of autism and all these learning disabilities. They are one of those straws that can break a camel's back in a person who is ready for it. But what they do, they bring the child closer to autism and closer to the problem if the child has got that problem. It is one of the factors. Usual winning diet, which is based on grains and milk usually, and the milk is usually the formula. That's the first thing that children are usually, even if the mother is breastfeeding, the formula is usually the first thing that is added into the child's regimen. They start topping up with formula if they feel that breast milk is not enough. And then the first thing that they introduce into the child as solids will be baby rice, a highly processed product which is very hard to digest, and other commercially available grain-based foods, which are very inappropriate for a gut full of abnormal gut flora. So the child finishes up with a frank gut dysbiosis after all this. That leads to the damage to the gut wall integrity. The wall of the gut becomes like a sieve. It cannot hold the toxic substances, the microbes in there, the undigested food in there, all these things flood into the bloodstream and get distributed all over the body. So toxins, microbes, undigested foods enter the body. And then, of course, our immune system, when it finds partially digested particles of food in the blood, it looks at them and says, you're not food, you're foreign, and starts attacking it. So we start developing T cells, specifically primed against particular proteins in the food. So the child starts developing food intolerances and food allergies. Toxins come in, the immune system reacts to those, and whole alive microbes come in. People who are familiar with live blood microscopy and people who had it done on their blood as patients or practitioners, there are quite a few practitioners here that came and spoke to me today. People who do live blood analysis, they see these things crawling in the blood, swimming in the blood, of all sorts of shapes and sizes. If the gut is intact, they're not supposed to get into the bloodstream, but they do. And of course, the immune system reacts to those, and a lot of reactions are inappropriate because the immune system is unbalanced in these patients. It is prone to overreacting and to reacting in an atopic, allergic, and autoimmune kind of way rather than in an appropriate way to these things. This is a picture of the absorptive surface of our digestive system. These long finger-like protrusions are called villi, and every villus is covered by tiny little cells called enterocytes that I've already mentioned. These are the cells which complete the digestive process. They break down particles of food and then absorb them. Each enterocyte is joined to its neighbor with a tight junction. They are glued together. These are called specifically tight junctions, and they are glued together by very special proteins called zonulins. They are like glue, these proteins. The body produces them. The only way the nutrients can get through the gut lining into the bloodstream, they have to be taken in by the enterocytes inside their cell, examined, digested, broken down, and then passed through the other side into the bloodstream. But what happens in these patients? These tight junctions break apart. The bacteria and various microbes can break them apart. They produce toxins which dissolve zonulins. So the tight junctions open up in these patients, and all these things start flooding in. That's what leaky gut is about. As I said, they only live a few days, these enterocytes. They get born at the bottom of the crypt, and then they travel up the villi, fulfilling functions of digestion and absorption of food, and then they get shed off. So they live about 2-3 days. And that way, our gut has a real opportunity to keep itself always young, always in a good shape, to fulfill its many functions. And it's a really good news for us, for people who try to treat digestive abnormalities, because if you put the person on a proper diet, If you put a person on a proper nutritional program, you have a real chance to shed off all the sick cells with broken tight junctions and replace them with healthy, newly born, good little cells. Each of these enterocytes has got hairs on its top, a thick forest of hairs, which are called microvilli, or brush border. And on each of these hairs, there are little enzymes sitting, those little bubbles sitting on them. And these are the enzymes which complete the breaking down of food to make them fit to be taken in by the enterocytes and then taken into the bloodstream. On the left, you see the healthy little guy. That's how enterocytes should look in a healthy gut with a healthy, robust gut flora when it's looked after properly. On the right, we've got a little poorly guy who is not looked after properly. That's how enterocytes look in a gut with abnormal gut flora, with gut dysbiosis. Their hairs are broken off. There is no brush border. There are no enzymes. So these cells are unable to break down the food. They're unable to absorb it. They're unable to fulfill their functions. The gut lining deteriorates in these patients. And I find that in majority of people, there are digestive symptoms, sometimes very, very severe, sometimes so severe that these are the first things that parents talk about when they bring their child to me, before they even mention the child's autism or hyperactivity or dyslexia or any other problem. But there is a small group of patients in whom the digestive symptoms are highly detectable. They say, my stool looks all right. I have no burping, no bloating, no pain, particularly nothing in particular. Because the digestive system has an ability to compensate. However, when we put that person on the nutritional program, on the GAPS nutritional program, the improvements in behavior and learning and all the other symptoms which are connected to it go very quickly, which is a clear indication that the abnormality was in the digestive system, despite the fact that the person was not suffering severely and did not have severe symptoms. It's particularly present in milder cases of learning disabilities, such as milder dyspraxia and milder dyslexia in these children. That's where parents find it particularly difficult to put the children on a restricted diet because they say, well, he doesn't seem to have any digestive problems. But when they do, the symptoms go away, the dyslexia starts going away, and the dyspraxia starts going away. So what happens in the damaged when the gut wall is damaged? Because it's not protected by beneficial flora and because it's being attacked by pathogenic microbes and its toxins all the time, its integrity degenerates. The enterocytes degenerate, tight junctions open, foods absorbed, partially digested, leading to food allergies and intolerances. Damaged gut lets toxins and microbes through into the bloodstream and general toxicity in the body issues from that. And of course, the immune system reacts, adding autoimmunity to the whole picture. What happens normally when the flow of food comes from the gut into the bloodstream? When we've eaten, we've digested, and it's all flooding into your bloodstream. The first place that all this lot arrives to is the liver. It's water-soluble nutrients and some fats and toxins. First, they go into the liver. They go into the bloodstream and into the liver. The liver handles them, detoxifies a lot of things, uses a lot of nutrients for building a myriad of active substances. Our liver is an amazing organ, and we still haven't studied it properly. We touched the tip of an iceberg with the liver. The liver is just such a complex and amazing organ. And then all that blood is collected from the liver into a lower portal vein, goes into your right heart, the right side of your heart. And what does the right heart do? It pumps it straight into the lungs. So our lungs are number two detoxifying organ in the body for everything that you've eaten. So your food first detoxifies through liver and then through the lungs. That happens to the water-soluble nutrients. What happens to fat-soluble nutrients? They absorb as blobs of fat, chylomicrons they're called, and they don't go into the bloodstream, they go straight into your lymph. And the lymph, what does the lymph do? It collects it all into thoracic duct, which goes directly into your right heart. It bypasses the liver. So the first detoxifying organ for fat-soluble toxins and fat-soluble nutrients is the lung. That's the first detoxifying organ that these substances hit. So what happens in the liver when the person has got GAP syndrome? Because that's what we're talking about. There is a river of toxicity flowing from the gut through the damaged gut wall into the bloodstream in these people. Toxins, undigested foods, microbes, they all come into the liver as the first port of call. And of course, the liver cannot cope with that load. It's not meant to cope with a load like that. So fairly quickly, when the gut gets damaged, the liver gets blocked up. Traffic jams build in the liver for all sorts of detoxifying pathways. It cannot handle this substance, then it cannot handle that substance, then it finishes up not being able to handle hundreds of substances, and these substances basically bypass the liver as a result and finish up in the bloodstream of the person. And from the environment, we can get heavy metals and phenols and petrochemicals and glue adhesives and agricultural chemicals and personal care cleaning products, plasticizers, and so on. These substances not only come through the gut, but they absorb through skin very effectively because most of them are fat soluble, which means that when you apply them to your skin, if you put your moisturizing cream or your deodorant under your armpits, or if you use a hair dye or your mascara or your shampoo or conditioner, anything chemical that you put on your skin or your scalp or in your mouth, the chemical substances from it are in your blood in seconds. And the first port of call is the liver, usually, again. So the liver not only just had to deal with the river of toxins coming from the gut, it cannot handle those substances as well. That is why the person who used heavy amounts of makeup for all her life, when her gut flora gets damaged and her liver gets blocked up, too busy trying to handle stuff coming from the gut, cannot handle mascara anymore. She suddenly becomes allergic to her mascara, or to her moisturizer, or to her shampoo, or to her hair dye, or to something else that she's used for years and was seemingly all right with it. That's what happens. The liver is blocked up. It cannot handle these things. It also cannot handle byproducts of body's own metabolism. One group of substances that we have studied quite well are neurotransmitters. These are chemicals that the brain and the rest of our nervous system produce in order to communicate between the cells. The cells communicate between themselves with neurotransmitters. Once these neurotransmitters have accomplished their multiple roles, they usually transport it to the liver, where the liver breaks them down and recycles them. But if the liver is blocked up with toxins coming from the gut, it cannot do that. So the body then fills up with partially broken down, partially damaged neurotransmitters, which are circulating around. And when we do tests for neurotransmitters, we find that they're all over the place. That some are too high, others are too low, and some of them are changed molecules. And of course, these things then cause problems with the nervous system. They would cause psychiatric problems, they would cause neurological symptoms and psychological symptoms and all sorts of other symptoms. And all liver functions suffer. When the gut is damaged, the liver cannot function well. You have to take it as a given that the liver is blocked up and not working properly if the person has got abnormal gut flora. The second port of call for toxins is lungs. So all these toxins, if the liver hasn't cleaned the stuff up, all this will hit the lungs next. So all these undigested foods and microbes. Normally, the liver handles certain toxins, particularly gases or substances that can turn into gases in the bloodstream. The lungs would eliminate these gases. And also the liver has got a so-called mucociliary escalator. It has got little cells with little hairs on their top, which are all pointing up. So when macrophages in the walls of the lungs absorb damaging microbes or toxins or other substances which should not be there, then they pass into the lumen of the lungs, and these cells push them up and up and up and up until you cough them out or breathe them out, and they come out of your body. Toxic gases escape, but what happens when the toxic load is too much for the lungs, or when the toxins that arrive to the lungs are unusual? Lungs are not meant to handle those toxins. It's the liver that was supposed to clean them out first. What happens? They damage the bronchi. They damage the bronchial tree. They would damage a certain part of the bronchial tree. What does the body do in order to repair that part of bronchi? It has to close that road up at the beginning and at the end. Just imagine bronchus as a motorway system. If there was an accident on the motorway and the tarmac got damaged, the lorry has broken down or something happened, in order to repair that tarmac, we have to close up the motorway, don't we? At both ends. So the builders can come in with their machinery, with their tarmac, and repair the stuff. And then the motorway can be opened. And that's what the lungs do with bronchospasm. And what happens when the bronchospasm happens? The person starts wheezing, and there is a difficulty to breathe. and it can be quite scary. And that situation usually happens in the second year of life in a child. And of course, the parents get frightened and they run to the doctor immediately. What does the doctor do? He says, ah, asthma. And give them drugs which take off the bronchospasm, open up that closed up bronchi, bit of bronchus. So what you've done with the motorway, you haven't closed it up. So you told the builders to somehow come and repair that tarmac while all the lorries and cars are going across it at 70 miles an hour. Can they repair it? They cannot. The builders cannot repair that part of motorway, and the more lorries are driving over it, and the more cars are driving over it, the deeper the damage becomes until that part of motorway becomes lethal. And that's what's happened with asthma. I'll talk about it in a minute. Asthma used to be a benign condition. If you look at old textbooks, up until Second World War, asthma was considered a very benign condition. Doctors have never seen death from asthma. It was considered a very mild and benign condition. The parents were told, if a child got the first wheeze, the parents were told, give him something hot to drink, keep him warm, let him sit up. It will take 10, 20, 15 minutes for the lung to repair that part of the motorway. And it will open up, and the child will be okay. But what happens nowadays, because of all the drugs that are being prescribed, because as soon as the child gets the first wheeze, immediately inhales are given, another drugs are given, which open that part of bronchial tree, so the repair does not occur. That part of bronchial tree does not get repaired. The damage gets deeper and deeper and deeper. And as a result of all this drug use, asthma became a fatal condition. Every 6 minutes in Britain now, a child is delivered into accident and emergency in the hospitals with a fatal asthma attack. Every 6 minutes. And this is for the condition that used to be absolutely benign and self-limiting. So now it's a deadly disease. Fatal food allergies are associated with well-controlled asthma as well. That's another observation that the scientists have made. So, we're talking about gut and physiology syndrome here. Physiology means the body, all the organs of the body except the nervous system, because that's gut and psychology syndrome. So, through elimination, simple elimination of toxins, that toxic flow that comes from the gut into the bloodstream, the body gets following conditions. As the toxins eliminate through lungs, we get asthma and other chronic lung conditions. Through skin, we get eczema, psoriasis, and other chronic skin conditions. All these various rashes that children get, which are itchy and come and go and weren't quite clear, and we don't know what to do with them. As they eliminate through urine, we get chronic cystitis, bed wetting, and thrush, because urethra and lower parts of bladder have got their own flora, and they also have got a so-called gag layer. It's a complicated name, but it is a layer of mucus that protects the mucous membranes of those organs from damage. But a lot of these toxins, which are then absorbed from the gut and go into the bloodstream, are eliminated from the body through urine. And when this very acrid urine comes into the bladder, accumulates into the bladder, it eats away at these mucous membranes, at this barrier. It damages it in these patients. And as a result, it burns and it causes symptoms and it causes an urge to eject urine as quickly as possible. And as the person starts passing this toxic urine day in and day out, that mucous membrane gets damaged chronically, the sclerotic process is set in, and the person finishes up with chronic cystitis, which doctors usually don't know how to treat, because an acute urinary infection they can treat with antibiotics. So if they can't give you antibiotics or they can't give you steroids, then they don't know what to do with you. You're possibly psychosomatic, and you might be sent to a psychiatrist as a result. But that's how chronic cystitis develops, and that's how bedwetting develops in children. And there are quite a lot of adults, and a growing number of adults now, who wet their beds. They're usually ashamed to talk about it to anybody, including doctors. What happens as the person sleeps, and if you're in a deep sleep, when your bladder accumulates that toxic, acrid urine, it wants to get rid of it because it's damaging it. And if you don't wake up, you wet your bed. That's what happens in children. Bedwetting usually goes away fairly quickly on GAPS nutrition protocol when we clean up the gut in the person. As the toxins eliminate through mucous membranes, whatever mucous membrane they pass, they would cause inflammation. and they would cause symptoms. You will get sinusitis, or postnasal drip, or rhinitis, or gingivitis, or vaginitis, or diarrhea, constipation, all chronic conditions in these people, unless the problem is dealt with. Autoimmunity joins in, as I mentioned, because the immune system is everywhere. It cannot fail to be involved in the whole situation. So autoimmunity in these patients is caused by absorption of protein and peptide complexes through the damaged gut wall. What is autoimmunity? Autoimmunity is when the body starts attacking its own tissues, when your immune system starts attacking its own tissues. And it starts doing that because of molecular mimicry. It's a phenomenon which has been studied first with rheumatism and streptococci. Because what the doctors found, and that research was conducted at the beginning of the 20th century, that when a person gets a strep throat, the streptococcus on its membrane has got proteins which look exactly like collagen proteins in the valves of the heart. Once the immune system develops antibodies against streptococci in the tonsils, it then finds those proteins in the valves in the heart and starts attacking them as well. And that's what causes rheumatism. That's called a molecular mimicry, cross-reaction, when the antibodies react to your own tissues. We live in a planet, in a world where everything is interconnected. Our bodies are not separate from the rest of the planet, from the rest of the ecosystem. The proteins that we have in our organs are very similar to proteins on the bacteria, on the insects, in the leopards, in the lions, in the rats, in the mice, in the rabbits. There is a huge similarity between these things. And once your cells learn about some protein that it is a foreign and that it's an enemy, they will retain that memory for the rest of your life. And we start accumulating that information now. T cells, these are the T cells, they're produced in the thymus gland. That's why they're called T cells. They retain that information for the rest of your life. However, the immune system is a very complex organ. Again, it's a system that we know not that much about. There are a lot of checks and balances on these T cells. We all have got T cells to cause multiple sclerosis, to destroy our myelin, and to cause rheumatoid arthritis, and to cause diabetes type 1. We all have got those T cells in our systems. But if your immune system is balanced well, it will not allow them to do that. And the balancing of the immune system is done by the gut flora. So when the gut flora is abnormal and the immune system suddenly gets out of balance, all those T cells which remember thousands of different proteins from the environment and from various bacteria and viruses and foods and toxins suddenly are not controlled anymore very well. And suddenly the person develops multiple sclerosis because these T cells attack the myelin, or develops rheumatoid arthritis, or develops lupus, or some other autoimmune conditions, or diabetes type 1. So it all comes down to the gut. Autoimmunity is born in the digestive system. So immune system produces antibodies, which then attack its own body's tissues, because the immune system is out of balance. In type 1 diabetes, pancreatic cells are attacked. In celiac disease, small intestine is attacked. In MS, autism, and other neurological problems, nervous system is attacked. There are the same antibodies detected in children with autism, patients with schizophrenia, obsessive compulsive disorder, bipolar disorder, as in autism, and as in rheumatoid arthritis, and as in many other autoimmune conditions. So there is a storm of autoimmunity going on because the immune system is not regulating itself. And always more than one tissue is attacked, despite the fact that the person might be given a specific diagnosis of, for example, rheumatoid arthritis, you would find symptoms which are similar in other conditions as well, because there are several number of T cells which are activated. To continue with gut and physiology syndrome, and to summarize, autoimmune conditions that belong to this condition, to gut and psychology, physiology syndrome, are multiple sclerosis, rheumatoid arthritis, diabetes type 1, celiac disease, osteoarthritis, lupus, and other autoimmune conditions. Arthritis of any kind. Autoimmunity is quite a serious situation in the body, but before that develops, what happens? A lot of toxins which are absorbed from the gut, which are not proteins, acetaldehyde, for example, a very toxic substance which is produced by yeasts in the gut. As it goes into the bloodstream, it likes to attach itself to various proteins in the body. And it seems that it's the collagen molecules, the protein collagen, which holds us together. It's actually the most ubiquitous protein in our bodies. Without collagen, we would be a puddle on the floor. It just holds us together. And there are many, many fractions of collagen molecules. And it seems that a lot of toxins which abnormal gut flora produces like to attach themselves to collagen molecules. And as they attach themselves to these molecules, they change their three-dimensional structure. So the immune system comes along, looks at it and says, you look foreign, you don't look like my collagen, and attacks it. So that's sort of an autoimmunity, but not in a full autoimmune blown attack. So the person gets a pain in that particular joint. And as the immune system then cleans up, as the body mobilizes inflammation, repair, and cleaning up processes, as the body cleans out those toxins from that particular joint, the joint might take for a day or two, and then that pain goes away. But a week later, you wake up with a pain in another joint. And in a couple of days, that clears away, and then you wake up with a pain in some other joint, in a small joint or big joint. And this is called migratory arthralgia. And it's caused by toxins which come from the gut and attach themselves to various proteins in the joints of the person. And there are many, many migratory symptoms like that, because collagen is everywhere in the body. Migratory symptoms like that in the human body, which come and go in these people. And these are the symptoms that usually confuse the doctors, and doctors usually don't want to deal with patients like that. So ME, fibromyalgia, chronic fatigue syndrome, also belong to GAP syndrome. They are gut and physiology conditions, syndrome conditions. Allergies, migraines and other headaches, chronic cystitis, skin problems, psoriasis, eczema, and so on. So we talked about gut and physiology syndrome. We talked about various organs in the body that can be affected because the gut wall is damaged, because the gut is full of abnormal flora. When these toxins reach a very specialized barrier called blood-brain barrier, they get into the brain, they get into the nervous system. That's where we come to gut and psychology syndrome, about which I've already got a book out. Blood-brain barrier generally is a very selective barrier. It's designed to let certain things through and not let the rest through at all. And its cellular structure is very similar to the gut structure. It's made out of cells, which are similar to enterocytes, and they also have got tight junctions between themselves, also with zonulins, those special proteins, gluing them together. And the toxins which the abnormal gut flora produces, which dissolve zonulins, once they reach the blood-brain barrier, they can do the same there as well. They dissolve those zonulins in there as well, and they open up the blood-brain barrier. So microbial toxins and various other things, and partially digested foods, flood into the brain and the rest of the nervous system through the damaged blood-brain barrier. And as a result, we get the impaired brain function, which leads to impaired learning, behavior, social skills, and perception. And it also leads to epileptic seizures. So here we talk about gut and psychology syndrome. So what kind of conditions are we talking about? We're talking about all the conditions I've already mentioned in the children. Autism, ADHD, ADD, dyslexia, dyspraxia, and that larger group of children, it's about 80% of children, who do not fit into any diagnostic box. They've got a bit of autism, a bit of ADHD, a bit of dyslexia, a bit of dyspraxia, and a bit of other symptoms which don't fit into anything. And these are the children that with whom doctors usually procrastinate. They don't give the diagnosis for a long time. They ask you to come back again and come back again to observe. And a valuable, precious time is ticking on while the child urgently needs help. The child can't even get a diagnosis yet. And when these children grow up, the condition doesn't go away unless you treat it appropriately. They become adults with GAP syndrome, GAPS adults. Substance abuse is one venue that these children usually take. There are two reasons for that. One is physical reason. Their brains crave nutrients, they crave certain things, and they get their cravings from things which they should not get it from, because these children are stuck in a vicious cycle of cravings and food dependencies. And they usually crave the foods which damage them, crave the foods which feed the abnormal flora. That's the physical reason for substance abuse. Another one is psychological, and majority of them have it, because these children grow up going through schooling and growing through the childhood and teenage years with poor social skills, not being able to make friends properly, not being able to fit in, being told by their peers at school that you're stupid and I don't want to play with you, and seeing that their peers in the classroom are doing better academically than they do. So their self-esteem takes quite a battering through their childhood. And when they reach teenage years, they would do anything to fit in, to be invited, to be wanted. And substance abuse is one of the venues that they take. And the trouble is that these children are likely to react inappropriate to recreational drugs. Several years ago, British government, as you probably all know, announced that cannabis is not that dangerous and classified it as a less dangerous substance, and it became far more available in this country. And then a year later, the psychiatrists started ringing the bells because they started getting growing numbers of youngsters who developed first psychotic episode and got diagnosed with schizophrenia after the first use of cannabis. You probably all know teenagers who go to parties and smoke cannabis at every party, and they're all right. They don't develop schizophrenia. But GAPS teenagers are vulnerable. They're the ones that usually develop psychosis after smoking cannabis for the first time. They've got vulnerability in their bodies. They're unable to take these substances. Depression is another GAPS condition, without doubt. These are digestive disorders. Psychiatrists don't want to know this. Despite the fact that the father of modern psychiatry, Philippe Pinel, in 1800s have concluded at the end of his long and illustrious career as a psychiatrist, he concluded that psychiatric disorders are born in the stomach and region of abdomen. That was his conclusion. And yet the modern psychiatry doesn't teach it to the students, and modern psychiatrists don't know it, and don't seem to want to know it because they've got all the arsenal of drugs to suppress the symptoms. Obsessive-compulsive disorder, bipolar disorder, which is manic depressive, and the king of them all, schizophrenia. They are all digestive disorders. I have quite a few patients in my clinic who are treated with GAPS nutritional protocol, and they do quite well. Though they're very, very complex, these patients, and the longer the patients was on antipsychotic medication, the more difficult they are to treat. If you catch a youngster who only had the first episode, then that's an imminently treatable condition. You can cure that person. And my dream is to set up a center in this country where these youngsters who just had the first psychotic episode, before they put on drugs, are put on GAPS nutritional protocol, are locked up in that facility and fed good diet and good supplements so their bodies can be cleaned up. And they don't have to live with schizophrenia for the rest of their lives, or bipolar disorder, or obsessive-compulsive, or depression, or anything like that. Epilepsy in children, that's another condition which is getting more common. 1% of population under the age of 20 suffers with epilepsy. 50% of children with mental problems have epileptic activity. And in 70% of cases, and that's a modest estimation, no cause is apparent. And again, our psychiatrists are not interested to know what's causing it. They don't ask that question. They don't look for it. They just control the symptoms. They put the person on anti-epileptic medication. If this one doesn't work, let's try this one. If that one doesn't work, let's add this one. Oh, there's a new one just come out. Let's try that one as well. And the poor child finishes up on a cocktail of anti-epileptic medication, which dumps down their brain, turns them into zombies, so they can't learn. So despite the fact that the child might have not had learning disability before, or behavioral problems, or anything, any other mental symptoms before, they just developed their first epileptic seizure. The child becomes learning disabled because they cannot learn, they cannot behave, their cognitive functions suffer because they're taking all this cocktail of medications which interfere with their brain function. In vast majority of cases of childhood epilepsy, it is due to toxicity coming from the gut. So the treat has to be concentrated on the gut health in these children. What happens in epilepsy, I believe, and my clinical experience confirms it, that an epileptic seizure is a safety valve for the brain. When the level of toxicity builds up too high in the brain, to a damaging level, the brain sends one electric discharge and burns the whole lot out. It's a cleansing procedure for the brain. That is why after an epileptic seizure, the person is more lucid, usually. And a lot of symptoms which were due to abnormalities go. But then as the toxicity builds up again, they come back. It's a very unfortunate safety valve, unfortunate cleansing procedure, but that's what it is. Once we clean up the gut, once we remove the source of toxicity, because these toxins that cause epilepsy come from the digestive system in the child. Once we remove that source of toxicity, the epilepsy usually goes away. So what do we do? How do we treat these patients? How much time have I got? 15 minutes. We treat them with a GAPS nutritional protocol. These are essentially digestive disorders. Digestive system is a long tube. What you fill that tube with has a direct effect on its well-being. So diet is the number one treatment, is the most important treatment, is the cornerstone. I had people asking me, well, can I do the program without the diet? Can we just take supplements? And unfortunately, there aren't easy answers. Anything worthwhile having in this world, it seems you have to work for. So there's a website called gaps.me. Please make a note of that. I have a long waiting list for my clinic. I'm overwhelmed with demands for consultations. It's not fair to make people wait for long periods of time to start the program, particularly when it comes to children. Because in children, every day is precious. There is a sense of urgency to start immediately with these children. That is why I've put as much information as I possibly could on that website and in my book as well, so people can do the program themselves without me being involved, without any supervision. And indeed, majority of people around the world do it without any supervision themselves. The book is a self-help book, and the website is a self-help website. I get new emails from out of the blue from people all over the world all the time saying that 2 years ago, we implemented your program, and we've got fantastic results now. That 2 years down the road, autism is pretty much gone, or ADHD is gone, or something else is gone. And it's wonderful to receive these emails, that people have done it themselves. An effective probiotic is essential, because we need to introduce beneficial bacteria into the gut of these patients, whether it's a child or an adult. There are many, many, many probiotics on the market. The food industry has jumped on the bandwagon now. There's more drinks and foods with added probiotics, and there are many supplemental probiotics. Majority of them are prophylactic. They're designed for healthy people to stay healthy, to keep themselves healthy. For people with GAP syndrome, you need a therapeutic strength probiotic. You need a powerful probiotic made out of powerful species of bacteria and in a good blend as well. A powerful probiotic would cause a die-off reaction. When you introduce these beneficial bacteria in the gut, they would start attacking Candida, killing it. They would start attacking Clostridia, killing it. They will start attacking Proteus and Staphylococci and Streptococci and many, many other pathogens which are overgrown in that particular patient. And when these critters die, they release toxins. And these are the toxins that give the person his or her individual symptoms, whether it's autism or depression or obsession or compulsion or inability to sit still, or whatever symptom it is. So if you suddenly give that person a lot of therapeutic probiotic, you would get quite a reaction. The regression would be quite serious. And that's called a die-off reaction. That is why with a strong therapeutic probiotic, you have to start with a tiny amount. You will get a die-off, go through the die-off, and then increase a little bit, then increase a little bit, and you increase gradually until you reach the therapeutic level of the probiotic. The levels of the probiotic I've described for different ages, I've described in my book, the dosages that are essential for different ages. So you control the die-off reaction. You don't try to avoid it altogether, but you control it at the level which is tolerable and at the level at which the patient can live with. It's very important to do that, particularly in patients with epilepsy, because you don't want to initiate an epileptic seizure or an epileptic status in a person. That's why you have to go quite slowly. And this build-up of the dose process is very individual. It depends on how severe the patient is. In less severe cases, they can sail through it in a matter of 3 weeks. In some cases, such as fibromyalgia or ME or chronic fatigue syndrome, I have patients who start from 1/8 of a capsule on the tip of a knife. They open the capsule, they pour the powder out, and on the tip of a knife, they take that dose and they get such severe die-off that they have to recover from it for a couple of days. Then they take another dose like that, then another dose like that. So it takes them to get to the therapeutic level several months, these people. So it all depends on how severe the condition is. Nutritional deficiencies need to be addressed. A lot of nutritional deficiencies can be diagnosed clinically, simply from the observation, observing the patient. the symptoms of the patient, the look of the skin, the muscle tone, the look of the nails, the look of the tongue, and the look of the eyes and everything else. But there are a lot of testing methods where you can test more specifically what nutritional deficiencies are, and there are a lot of good supplements, natural supplements on the market that you can use. And detoxification is an important part of the treatment. So what is the diet? Let's go quickly through the diet. We'll go quite quickly. Sally has given a fantastic presentation on food today, so I can go quite quickly through this subject. And the interesting thing is that I have developed this diet completely independently before coming across Weston A. Price Foundation. I didn't know about its existence. When my book was on the market for a few years, and then I came across the work of Weston A. Price and found Sally, we were surprised to find how many similarities there are between the diet that I treat these patients with and the Weston A. Price diet. The first thing we have to address in these patients is the fussy eating habits before we even start talking about the foods. Because when I start talking about the diet, the first thing the parent says, ah, he will not eat that. I cannot force him. I cannot make him or her to eat that. These children, majority of them, and adults as well, and siblings of GAPS children, siblings of autistic children, and dyslexic children and hyperactive children are quite often very fussy eaters. And quite often it is a first sign of GAPS, of GAPS syndrome in these patients. Because these siblings got their gut flora from the same parents as their autistic brother or sister did. So they would have the same abnormal gut flora. They just have different constitution and different other things happen differently for them in life. So they did not develop autism. And they did not develop another severe condition. But they usually suffer from digestive problems, can be quite mild, that they can live with. They can be slightly hyperactive, they can be slightly absent-minded, they can have slight social skill problems, they can have eczema, they can have asthma, they can have various allergies, the siblings of these children. Because I say they got the same gut flora from the same parents, so they need to be treated as well. And I find that I have to treat the whole family, because the parents are also affected by abnormalities of gut flora. They usually have got gut and physiology syndrome conditions, despite the fact that their mental functioning might be sound. So the first sign is the fussy eating habits. These children and adults have got solid physiological reasons for being fussy with food. They're not fussy because they are bad, badly behaved or anything like that. They are trapped in a vicious cycle of cravings and dependency on the very foods which damage them, which harm them. What happens? Candida, Clostridia, Proteus, Staphylococcus, Streptococcus, and other pathogens which overgrow in the gut like particular foods. And these are usually starchy, stodgy, processed carbohydrate foods. Once they feast on these foods, they produce their toxins. And part of their toxins have an endorphin structure. When they absorb and get into the brain, they give the brain a pleasure signal. So the brain wants more. Another thing that happens in these children that from the very young age, usually from the moment when they are, when the solids are introduced, at the age of 4 to 6 months of age, these children learn that food makes me ill. I get a tummy ache, my joints aching, my body's aching, I might get a headache. Of course, the baby can't tell you all this because the baby's not speaking yet, but the baby might refuse food. That's the cause of failure to thrive. We have a growing number of babies in our modern world who fail to thrive because they refuse solids. They would not take these solids. Many of them finish up on drips, on regular visits to hospital when they have to lie down and feed them through the vein with elemental nutrition because these children basically losing weight at a dramatic rate and cannot gain any weight and would not eat. Because this child has abnormal gut flora, these are GAPS children. And they know that solids are making them ill, so they naturally refuse these things. But children who do not refuse these things, they learn to live with them, and they learn subconsciously that food makes me ill, so I would refuse foods apart from the foods which give me that kick, which the foods which feed that vicious cycle of cravings and dependency. So they typically limit their diet to the foods which feed that vicious cycle. So they would usually eat crackers, breakfast cereals, bread, anything made out of flour and sugar, anything sugary, very sweet yogurts, a banana perhaps, or pasta. Sounds familiar? There are a lot of children who would eat that. And if you manage to stuff anything into their mouth, it has to be smothered in ketchup sauce or something else sweet. in these children. There are a lot of children in our modern world who are not diagnosed with anything in particular, but they have got this pattern of eating. More than 90% of children with learning disabilities suffer from fussy eating habits. They limit their diets to sweet and starchy foods with solid physiological reasons. I have a whole chapter in my book which explains how to break this vicious cycle. Your child will not be able to break out of it on its own. Your child needs your help, intensive help. And as you try to help, he or she will fight you every step on the way, like a drug addict. You have to see them as drug addicts. Treating drug addicts is a very unthankful process because they fight you every step on the way. And there is a solid, structured approach how to do that. I had children in my clinic who would eat one food. There was one little boy who looked like one of those Ethiopian children from starving Ethiopia several years ago. Thin little legs, rickets, and a big sticking out belly. This child was 3 and 2 months old, and he lived from the age of 6 months on cream crackers of a particular brand. He would not eat anything else, this child. And the parents kept taking the child to nutritionists under the NHS, and the nutritionists and dietitians were saying, it's all right, he's eating, give him more cream crackers. And following the program that I've described in my book in this chapter, It's Feeding Time or No, a couple of months later, this child was eating everything, meats and fish and vegetables and fruit and all the foods that parents put in front of the child. So this vicious cycle can be broken, but it needs to be approached in a very structured way. Using, it's based on behavior modification. Using behavior modification technique, you can achieve 100% success. So talking about the diet now, so what foods do we avoid? We avoid all the foods which are difficult to digest, which Sally outlined beautifully. Plant foods are difficult to digest. Vegetarians, can you hear that? Plant foods damage our gut. And grains and lentils are number one. Grains and leguminous foods are the number one. They are full of substances which damage the gut. These children and adults already have got damaged gut. They cannot handle these things. They cannot digest them in any shape or form. So they have to be removed for long enough time for those enterocytes to rebuild new layers in the gut, to repair themselves, to restore the gut. On average, it takes a couple of years. The younger the child, the quicker they recover. Adults take longer than children, in general. But it is the good thing about this diet that you don't have to stick to it for the rest of your life. You stick to it for a period of time until the gut is healed, and then you can gradually start introducing other foods and start eating in a more versatile way. But of course, as you went through this diet, majority of people find that they cannot go back to their processed and junk food diet that they used to eat before. So all grains have to be removed, all grains and anything made out of them, and that's wheat, rice, rye, oats, millet, quinoa, tapioca, couscous, amaranth, the lot. All starchy vegetables, potato family, has to be out, parsnips have to be out. Sugar and all commercial sweetness. Our commercial powers keep coming up with new commercial sweetness, with new artificial sweetness. I keep getting phone calls and emails from people all the time. Well, what do you think about this new sweetener? What about this one? What about xylitol? What about... Don't trust any of them. Do not touch any of them. Nature has provided us with wonderful sweetness, which are good for us. Milk sugar lactose has to be removed. Starchy beans, including soy. There's only one variety of beans that is allowed, and that's only later on in the diet, because even those beans contain lectins and phytates and other substances, which are very hard for GAP's gut to handle. All processed foods naturally have to be out, and all food additives. In this diet, everything the child or the adult eats has to be cooked at home from fresh ingredients. No takeaways, no eating out, because you cannot guarantee what's been put in that food and how that food has been cooked. Recommended foods, what do we actually eat? All meats cooked from fresh or frozen. All fish cooked from fresh or frozen. Organ meats are very important. Once a week, at least, liver has to be eaten. I give a lot of recipes to the parents how to include liver on a daily basis into the child's diet. I recommend that you cook a whole liver with other meats, make a beautiful meat stock, make a beautiful bouillon from it, and then you grind it with some bouillon in your food processor into a fine slop, fill up an ice cube tray, freeze it, and then add an ice cube into a meal every day into your child's meal. That's one of the easy coping strategies that a lot of parents do for liver. But liver is not optional for these children. They have to have it on a daily basis or in small amounts every day or a good full liver meal once a week. Good quality eggs, non-starch vegetables, and that means all vegetables are allowed, apart from potato, exotic potatoes, and parsnips. So that's a very large choice of vegetables. All ripe fruit. Fruit has to be ripe, because unripe fruit is full of starches, which are hard to digest. As the fruit ripens, the starches get converted, broken down into monosugars, and the fruit is much easier to digest. That is why when you buy tropical fruits and other fruits, majority of commercially available fruit in supermarkets is unripe. So it has to be bought and kept in a warm place to ripen, if it would ripen. Some fruit doesn't ripen at all, so you have to cook it. Nuts and seeds are an important part of the diet. Fermented dairy. When we ferment milk, we are fermenting bacteria. Bacteria like eating sugars, so they immediately eat lactose. So well-fermented dairy products are lactose-free. There's your lactose-free dairy products. Apart from that, what happens? These bacteria pre-digest the proteins and the sugars and other substances in milk. So well-fermented dairy products are pre-digested. They're very easy for a damaged digestive tract to handle. That is why they're included into this diet. However, there is a small percent of patients who are allergic to dairy. So with those patients, we have to follow a particular protocol, which I describe in my book on page 95. Cold extracted honey is the sweetener allowed. Natural fats. That's a very, very important part of the diet. As Sally already told you, fevers, detoxification, exertion, any vigorous activity the body has to do consumes vitamin A and vitamin D and vitamin K and many other nutrients at an alarming rate. These children, as they detoxify on the program, they will be consuming huge amounts of vitamin A. Nobody has ever measured it. We don't know what the levels should be, and we would never know. But if we provide ample amounts of these vitamins in a food form, then if we provide too much, the body would know how to deal with it. Because excessive amounts of these vitamins, when it comes in a food form, the body knows what to deal with it. It's not going to cause any harm. But if you provide supplements of those vitamins, then you can overdose quite easily. That is why I recommend these substances only in a food form. That is why I recommend liver, and I recommend egg yolks, and I recommend cream and butter and animal fats. As Sally outlined very beautifully to you, the most important fats for us humans to consume are animal fats. This is something that majority of people find it very difficult to get their mind around. Because we grew up in a society of fat phobia and cholesterol phobia. People who are in their 20s and 30s now have grown up from this age, seeing advertisements on TV, which are fat-free, and low-fat, and protects your heart, and anti-cholesterol, and lowers cholesterol. So they grew up thoroughly brainwashed, these people. They're afraid of animal fats. They're afraid of cholesterol. They're afraid of these sort of things. But if you look at the structure of the human body, at the structure of human cells, of membranes and cell walls, about half of the fats that we made from are saturated. Another 30% are monounsaturated, such as oleic fatty acid. And only the rest of it are various varieties of polyunsaturated fatty acids. So if we do need polyunsaturates, and I'm sure all of you heard about the fish oils and the flax oil and hemp oil and many, many other oils, they've been promoted very vigorously by the health movements in the last few years. These oils, these fatty acids, need to be consumed in tiny amounts. And if you're on a good diet, you will get them in food. You don't need to supplement them. What you do need in huge amounts, in large amounts, are animal fats. So eat your crackling on your pork, and eat your fat on your lamb chops, and eat the fatter cuts of beef, and eat the egg yolks, and eat tons of butter. You cannot overload on butter. Particularly if you eat porridge in the morning. In Russia, we've got a saying, you cannot spoil the porridge with butter. So if you have a little bit of porridge and lots of butter, it will be better, better for you. So all the animal fats needs to be the main fats that humans should consume. Not the hemp oil, not the flaxseed oil, not the sunflower oil, not the fish oil, and not all the other polyunsaturated oils. If you're eating raw vegetables, if you're eating raw fruit, if you're eating nuts, particularly uncooked nuts, you will get plenty of these polyunsaturated fatty acids. You don't need to supplement them. You don't need any extra. Coconut oil and palm oil are very, very good. They're largely saturated, but their value also is in specific fatty acids which are antimicrobial, antiviral, and anti-candida, antifungal. So coconut oil can be used as an antifungal supplement. And it also tastes nice. You can eat it as it is. And a lot of people who have sugar cravings find that if they have a couple of tablespoons of coconut oil when they have a sugar craving, the craving goes away. It's more difficult to eat pork fat that way, isn't it, or goose fat? But the coconut oil, you can. Obviously, avoid all fats and fat replacements that the food industry is trying to convince us to eat. This is a book that I've written in response to my patients. Going back to the previous slide, when I would start talking about this subject, the natural question that everybody would immediately ask me, am I going to die from a heart attack from your diet? What about my heart? What about my cholesterol? What about, I had a test of cholesterol a couple of weeks ago and it was high. Can I eat all these animal fats? And having explained to a 100th patient that natural cholesterol and natural fats have nothing to do with heart disease, in fact, they prevent it, I thought I'd better write a book about it. And this book was the result of these recommendations on the diet. The book is available here. So for any of you who are interested to know what fats actually cause the heart disease, what these fats do in the body, what kind of cholesterol there are, and what kind of cholesterol we should be avoiding and which not, please read the book. Supplementation is an important part of the program. I do not believe in eating a lot of supplements. I believe that we need to get our nutrition from food, not from pills. This is a minimum list of supplements that I give to my patients. I give them absolute minimum, 3 supplements, and they're all foods. They're not really supplements. One, an effective probiotic. Another one, cod liver oil, which will provide vitamin A and vitamin D, and some varieties provide vitamin E and even K in little amounts. And essential fatty acids. Because there is a lot of research to show that fish oils, in particular, help in dyslexia, dyspraxia, and other conditions. One condition I would warn not to give essential fatty acids in, it is epilepsy. Evening primrose oil, sometimes cod liver oil, and fish oil can trigger epileptic fits. We don't know why, whether some sort of detox goes on, or restructuring in the brain goes on, or whether something toxic going on, but these people should not take these oils. So for them, just an effective probiotic and a little amount of cod liver oil is enough. I would not give them any other supplements until the seizures are well under control. Multivitamin mineral amino acid supplement is optional. I give it to a small percentage of people when we've got some niggling problems and we're not quite dealing with them. So the initial program to tackle the problem is the diet, the probiotic, and cod liver oil and fish oil. That's all you need. You don't need anything else. Digestive enzymes, again, are optional. A lot of people with abnormal gut flora cannot produce enough stomach acid because toxins which are produced in the gut impair stomach acid production. So a lot of them benefit, particularly adults benefit from taking HCl and pepsin to start with, or betaine HCl. And some people find it helpful to take pancreatic enzymes at the end of their meal. However, majority of people don't notice anything particular happening with these enzymes. So for them, it isn't essential. Detoxification is an important part of the program. And I believe in natural detoxification. Juicing is a time-honored and time-proven method of removing all sorts of toxins from the body without any side effects. Baths with Epsom salt, sea salt, cider vinegar, and toxins have to be avoided. Avoiding toxin exposure is a very important part of the treatment. I've got a whole chapter on it in my book. This is the book. I've got a couple of examples of patients, but I think we've run out of time. 1 minute, so we'll sail through it quickly. This little boy, who is 9 years old now, he was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes, celiac disease, and autism at once in his second year of life, poor chap. He was put on insulin injections at 15 months. Autistic development started from 18 months of age. He was nonverbal, dyspraxic, diarrhea with undigested food, used to be severely constipated, bloating, reflux, finicky eater, malnourished, pale. He had eczema, allergies, poor sleep. He was not potty trained and diagnosed as a celiac. We started GAPS program in May 02, at the age of 3 and a half. In 6 months, he had normal stools, eczema has cleared, he had much better feeding habits, he put weight on, he was not pale anymore, and he had a better sleep. In a year, he had great improvements in language development and social skills, got potty trained. In a year and a half at mainstream school, and had many friends, autism and dyspraxia were almost undetectable. The daily dose of insulin was halved. And now there are no traces of autism or dyspraxia, school champion in karate, insulin injections only occasionally at a low dose. So his diabetes type 1 also pretty much gone. This child, Leandro, he had idiopathic generalized epilepsy and Asperger's syndrome, had normal development till the age of 2, was very bright, Italian family, had colic and was prone to constipation and had lots of colds. Around 2 became fussy with food, hyperactive, limited his diet, got abnormal stools and became malnourished. At 3 and a half, after fever, got absences, by 4 gram mild epileptic seizures and absences 10, 15 times a day. So these poor parents lived in fear all the time, watching this child like a hawk. He regressed in language and learning ability. He got obsession, self-stimulation, he became hyperactive, and he was taking about 5 different anti-epileptic medications, and the seizures were not controlled. Medication for epilepsy, sodium valproate, was the one that was left eventually. Poor control of seizures, became aggressive, unable to learn, and personality changed. At 7, he started GAPS nutritional protocol. In 3 months, he was better physically, but the parents felt that medication, particularly sodium valproate, from the beginning of the program, they removed other medication, they just left the sodium valproate, was causing the seizures and interfering with the learning ability. So they started reducing the dose under supervision, of course. In 9 months, they reduced the dose to 250 milligram. He had no gram mal at that stage, 1-4 mild absences a day. He was thriving at mainstream school, greatly improved language and learning, better social skills, had friends, stools were normal, and good eating habits. In 20 months, he was off all medication. He had occasionally very mild absence, physically was healthy, not hyperactive anymore, normal behavior, social skills. Academically, he was 2 years behind. Then the family moved to South Africa, and I lost contact with them. But at that stage, the absences that the child had were very occasional, and they were so mild that people who didn't know him wouldn't notice anything. It's only parents who knew the whole history would notice that he was having an absence. But otherwise, he had these very, very mild absences that nobody could identify. These are my contact details and the website. Thank you very much for listening.